Women have been successful in recent decades in using collective power to challenge gendered forms of insecurity. But what do we mean by the term gender, and how is it relevant to the way we think about security? The term gender relates to a system of values that shape how we expect women and men to behave in our societies.
It's not something to do with physical differences. It's about the kind of expectations that we place upon people according to whether they are male or female, whether they are a boy or a girl or a man or a woman. It's the expectations, it's the opportunities or the lack of opportunities that comes as a result.
Power is integral to how this system works. In many societies, the status of men and the roles they occupy are socially invested with greater power than the roles and positions that are typically occupied by women. Men and women may experience distinct sorts of challenges to their security because of their gender. The differing ways men and women are able to access power may also mean men and women have different resources to hand to resist or recover from insecurity. Looking at the question of security in our communities through a gendered lens often allows us to uncover stories of insecurity experienced by marginalized groups of women and men that may otherwise be hidden. In the Pacific region, personal safety is often hard for women to find. Rates of violence against women are recorded at extreme levels in some countries. This violence often spikes further when conflicts impact on their communities. But even when conflict is not present, this violence may see as many as 2 in 3 women exposed to family or conjugal violence in their lifetime. Women also frequently struggle to make their political claims heard or understood. Politics in this region is often seen as men's business, so women are underrepresented in parliamentary institutions at rates lower in Pacific Island countries than in most other parts of the world. So how did Pacific women have the power to influence positive changes in policy on gender and security? In recent decades, women's organizations have worked hard to build peace through collective action in their communities. Sometimes this can involve things like women's peace vigils, an initiative that was led by women like Sharon Bagwan Rolls in Fiji in response to the 2000 coup.
The Blue Ribbon Peace Vigil was very catalytic in terms of FemLink Pacific, as well as the Women's Action for Democracy and Peace, which was really one of the first coalitions of women coming from many political perspectives and organizations.
These types of activities can also lead to new and innovative strategies to make women's voices heard. Ms. Bagwan Rolls went on to develop a women's organization called FemLink Pacific that uses communication technology to improve the standing of women in their community.
The suitcase radio is a very important tool in many ways. It addresses the women's access to information communication technology and claiming the airwaves. And so through the women's stories that get broadcast on the suitcase radio, one, we're providing a safe space, particularly after the military coup, that women could still, the radio could still go to them, they could talk about their issues and be able to analyze things from a human security perspective.
In November 2012, the Pacific Islands Forum, the region's premier intergovernmental organization, formalized the Regional Action Plan on Women, Peace and Security. This was a major achievement for Pacific women in their regional struggle for recognition and equality. The Regional Action Plan sought to localize the United Nations Women, Peace and Security agenda and to make foreign member states more fully aware of their obligations to uphold women's security in line with UN Security Council Resolution 1325. Sharon Bhagwan roles also played an important regional role in changing decision makers' views on gender, security and peace, and won their support for a new regional policy on this agenda.
When it comes to 1325, it's about taking a feminist perspective, looking at women's interpretations of security. So we first had to say it's not just about sexual gender-based violence or domestic violence, that when women talk about security, they're talking about political security, land security, economic security. So we've persisted in that. And I think with that going, and that's been really important in terms of providing a feminist civilian perspective on security.
The plan provided an important new lobbying platform for making women's contributions to peace building heard, while drawing attention to the economic and social costs of the violence women may suffer during periods of conflict. Women also use collective power in this campaign in two key ways. First, working locally, they built awareness at the grassroots level so that women understood why this policy framework coming down from the United Nations Security Council was important for their own situation.
The regional network first came about because we were all women leaders who had been engaged in some type of peace building or peace interventions or human rights work in response to political crises in Solomons, Bougainville, Tonga, and of course Fiji. So it was first and foremost about recognizing that if we're talking about 1325, it's about participation. And if we want to engage in any aspect of peace and security, that as women we need to be organized.
Second, women peace leaders from Fiji, Bougainville, Solomon Islands, and Papua New Guinea also formed a powerful coalition called the Pacific Peace Women to lobby support from amongst the region's policymakers. They held regular meetings with state leaders and decision makers to promote the idea that there is a positive association between women's peacemaking and regional security.
A lot of it was about awareness raising, building awareness amongst the state and regional intergovernmental organizations of their accountability to 1325, that it's not just a tool for women to use, but we're actually giving ideas of how governments and regional intergovernmental organizations should be applying 1325.
Acceptance of this policy was the culmination of a hard-fought and determined 10-year campaign by women peace activists.
It's about how can men and women as peace builders work together in their countries, and of course the ability for our network to influence, engage and lead in the drafting and the adoption of the Regional Action Plan on Women, Peace and Security. I think that's really created that model of what is possible when you localize the vision of 1325, which was women peace activists engaging with the UN system and government.
It was an important moment for gender advocates, showing that despite a range of sociocultural and political hurdles, questions of gendered security can and should carry weight at the highest levels of regional governance.